Welcome to the Totally Awesome Fishing Show. Yes, gotta be the best all-round fishing show on YouTube run by two people, me and Mike. Anyway, I was going through the tackle, as you do when it's wild, windy, wet, stormy, and I was appalled at the state of my rods, especially my beach rods, because I mean, I did quite a bit of shore fishing last year, making films, rock fishing off the beaches, off the shingle, put them down, film, oh dear, it's got a chip on it. Now, I'm not what you would call a tackle tart by any stretch of the imagination. Now, don't laugh. I still catch fish though. But if you look after your tackle, it will last you years. And to do that, you know, you need to have it all serviced, all looked after. Now, you don't have to just buy something off the shelf. Years and years ago, we used to, all my group, all the guys I knew, like in the late teens, we just used to get kit rods. You'd get a kit, you get the rod blank, you get whatever rings you wanted, you get the winch fittings, you get all the foregrips with it, you get the butts, and you would build your own rod. You would dope it, you would varnish it, you would epoxy it, you would build it totally yourself. So they're a total personalised rod just for you. And I'm talking here trout, course, sea, beach, even big game. Now I've got a big game rod behind me just to show you the standard that can be achieved with some of these guys that do rod building. Not me, my rings stay on, but they're not like these guys. Now this is an 80 pound trolling rod that had a curved butt, and I had it done by a guy, I think his name was Earl Hamilton. He did the most immaculate work in Britain on rod building, end of. If you look down here, you can see the high build epoxy over, I think they're Mildrum rollers, black and gold Mildrum rollers that I had on this rod. And he's done the most beautiful, what they call diamond wrap, coming down just above the foregrip from the butt there. Beautiful. He's even got what I call firebirds in there. Now these guys, when you look at these aren't stuck on. These are whipped in with silk, with multi threads of silk of different colours that he bonds in there and overlays and gets them touching turns. Now, I've had a go at it, okay, and I can tie the diamonds, you know, what we call a diamond wrap like that, but some diamonds are off this way, some are off that way, to get them dead straight, it's not happening with my eyes now, that's for sure. So it got me thinking about rod building. People don't do that much now. So let's try and learn something about rod building, and who should I really track down? Only possibly the longest serving traditional British rod builder in British history. He's been tying since the age of 16, Graham Dadsall is his name. He ties commercially, mostly for the trade, but he's starting to do more and more for private individuals that want repairs to their rods, and also they might want a rod built to their own specifications with a modern blank. I tracked him down, took a while, found him in West Sussex, and went down to interview him, and he does beautiful work, and he knows Earl as well. They all know each other in these little circles because there are so few. I think there's probably only 4, 5 or 6 in the whole of Britain that have been going long term building rods, and Graham is possibly the one, the longest serving one. So let's get down there. I might even take this down and show him, but I don't want to upset him, do I? This is an immaculate job that Earl did. Let's go down there and see if we can give you a bit of an insight into how a fishing rod is built British style. Well, I'm here down in West Sussex and I'm taking the Stairway to Paradise. I'm going to meet Graham Dadsall, a top, possibly the last remaining of the original rod builders, and he's going to give us some tips.
Whoa!
How many rods are in here? Graham, good to see you.
Hello, Graham.
Graham to Graham, this is. You've got double Grahams in this episode, it might be a nightmare. Well, you've certainly got some rod blanks in here. I don't know, good old Conoflex, one of my favourite rod blanks, is one of your mainstay ones. And you've been trying to... It's so hot in here. Look at the cat. The cat's even flaked out on the floor.
Oh, yes.
I mean, why is it so hot? Is that to do with the varnishing or something?
Yeah. All has to be kept warm.
Kept warm,
high temperature. I'm putting the resin in it on so it flows.
Gotcha.
Nice. And I like to keep all my blanks at the same temperature, the same room temperature as the resin.
How hot will you get here? I mean, how warm do you have to have it?
On the days I'm putting resin on, I'll work at 78 degrees.
78,
which is very...
It's lovely, because it's a horrible winter. It's a horrible winter out there. It's rain, and more rain.
Yeah.
Right, let's take a look at... you're going to bring us through rod building, because there's going to be people that are interested in not necessarily building a rod themselves, you know, because years ago, we used to build our own rods and buy kits,
ironically supplied, not from Conflex, they used to supply all the different fittings, etc. But people do want customised rods, you know, so let's take a look at something, give us an idea, you know, what your sort of standard of finish is.
Okay, Graham, let's have a little look at what we do. I'll do a full range of Conflex rods, from like the Flatley Fanatic, right up to the big beach casters, tournament casters. We do the boat rods, uptide rods, which you're familiar with. And any kind of rod, really. I do carp rods, quiver tip rods, everything, really.
Right through fresh water. You do all the fresh water stuff as well?
Yeah, fresh water, yeah.
Did you match in a way, or have you done trout? You must have done every rod going, I imagine.
Yeah, I was doing a lot of trout work several years ago, and I did some work for David Norwich, and some prototype work for one of the bigger companies and stuff. So we've done that, and my mainstay is the Conflex work. That's been consistent for quite a few years now.
Beach and boat, this would be, wouldn't it?
Beach, boat, yeah. And then after the standard boat, we went on to uptiding, which has become very popular. So we do a full range of uptide rods.
Give us a little bit of an insight into your history. When did you start? When did you actually start into the rod
building? I
started
doing repairs when I was 15.
15?
Yeah, we lived in the village, and out of West Overley there. And just doing our own repairs, then moved to Birch Seal, started working for a local shop, buying all the rings and stuff, and gradually went on to build for him. And then after that, moved on, started working for Conflex. And I've already been building on the Conflex rods for different shops.
Sure.
And just gradually progressed from there. And once I was working for Conflex, then we gradually developed different rods, different planks.
So you started with Michael McManus. You did start with Michael, yeah?
Yeah.
In the original era, which is still ongoing. With Aidan and Stephen, Aidan, so very famous. Yeah. And it's British company, that's a big thing I think we'll point out. It's like a British company.
I like the association with British built rods and what have you. And there are other companies, but Conflex probably do the most diverse range of rods that are made in this country.
And for anglers that don't know, you know, the blank is just the base. It's like a fibreglass or carbon fibre or whatever, carbon and glass mix of tube. And you've got some here. Now, when I used to do the rod building years ago, bear in mind it's not quite your standard, but I always used to have trouble. I used to get mixed up with what they call the spine. If you can tell us about the spine on the rod.
Well, the spine is grown. If I take this rod here, which is a Demon Uptide, just for instance. We roll the blank round, just put some pressure on the tip.
Yes.
Roll the tip. Rolled actual blank round.
Now, when you're rolling it, you're doing it with your fingers there, aren't you? You're just twisting the blank round, rotating it.
Yep. Compress the tip and gradually rotate it, and you'll feel, you can see that, you can see that when that bounces out. They'll always want to bend the same way.
Yes.
When it's compressed, so you see that there?
So now, what is causing that spine on the blank? Just to explain to people, what is it?
When the blanks are actually rolled on a mandrel, they're... you won't get the cloth finish in a dead straight line. So obviously as it's rolled, then the cloth will end in a different place as it goes around the...
Like sort of spiraled margin. Around the bank, really?
Yeah, it'll gradually, and depending on the cut and what have you, with the material. If you imagine it's thicker at one end, obviously thinner at the other.
Yes.
So as it's rolled, it will...
Overlap one end.
As it comes up to the tip.
I've got you.
As that's rolled out, then obviously you can't get it in a straight line flowing up there.
Yeah.
So as it's rolled round, that's what creates the spine in a rod.
Now I always had trouble.
It'll always have the same. It will always compress in the same place.
You can feel it. You can definitely feel the ridge, can't you? All rods, you do this. You can feel it. But it's got to be without the rings on, isn't it? Yeah.
You don't. It's harder to find in glass. You don't get such a spine in glass fibre. But these days with modern carbons and stuff, they're much easier to find.
Now, do you put the spine, if you can imagine, I'm trying to describe it to people, because it's something you actually feel, isn't it? Do you put that so that it's fighting the fish is the stiffest bit, or for casting is the stiffest bit? Where do you put the rings in relation to the spine?
Well, I would want it for actual fishing, so I'd want that. So on a beach caster, where your eyes are facing you.
Yeah.
I would want that tip eye. If I was putting that on there, I would put the tip eye on the top facing up.
Yeah.
So it's like away from the spine.
So you're pulling into the hardest bit, as it were, yeah?
Yes.
Yes, yeah. I see.
On a beach caster. And then as that, it compresses nicely as you take the load.
Yeah.
You want that to compress nice. So you don't want it twisting. Because if it twists, that's going to affect the casting and the performance of the rod.
I see.
So as that goes, you want that to stay in line.
So it's quite important. Otherwise, putting those rings on then, you know, getting yes. them on the spine.
Yeah. Because if you don't, as that compresses, it's going to want to twist the way it wants to go. And the harder you compress it, the more that will be exaggerated. So if we put it on the top there, tip goes nicely and then follows down the blank nicely with a nice ringing pattern. And that'll make the rod compress nice, which is what you want for the...
And the same for like uptiders and boat rods, sea rods, the same thing. Yes, regular uptiders would be the same principle.
No, on a boat rod, I'll do it the other way around on that. So that would sit on the top. So the softer side, I'd want so it's going down on the tip rod.
Yes.
So that would go.
Because you're not casting.
You're not casting it. And that would show, being that the softer side.
Yeah.
Would give you a better bite indication.
Ah, it's interesting.
And again, when it goes over, as the compression travels down the bank, you don't want it twisting.
Yes.
That's what you've had rods in the past.
They pull to the side.
And they pull to the side, or they want to turn.
Yeah.
And that's because that's the way the natural curve of the blank wants to go. So if you can follow the line of that, it's a much smoother, much more pleasant playing action.
Okay, well, have you got a cart? Let's start with, a cart rod blank. Have you got a rod that you're working on, or we can show everybody how you work on this?
Okay, Graham, we've got a cart rod tip here. So first thing I'll do is mark the first piece of tape around the tip section. Just about an inch back from the tip. I'll help you. Once I've done that, I want to mark that in the direction of the spine. So what I'll do then is compress that. I'll compress that blank, that, and then rotate the blank. Right, yeah. You see that there, Graham, all right? So that'll be rotating. Just roll it around a couple of times, and you'll feel where that blank wants to, where it naturally wants to lay. Right, once I've got that position there, then I'll mark the...
So the tape is there for the to mark it.
It's purely so I can put a marker on it, just to mark the position of the where I want the eye to go, where I want the tip eye to sit. So I'll mark that on the underside, and that is the natural way that blank wants to curve.
On the cart rods, any particular tip eye? What's the latest material? Silicon carbide, tungsten, la di da. Whatever. What's the latest thing?
Silicon carbide is.
It's still there. Still used.
Oh yes, yeah. Yeah, originally we would have had the plain wire ones back in the early days.
Yeah.
Then we come through different ceramics. Agate.
Ice. Agate, that was the word. I couldn't think of the word then, yeah.
Agates. Then we went on to the oxide, which was the standard.
Aluminium oxide, yeah.
Yeah. Then we went on zirconium.
Can't remember that one.
Right, they were sort of in between. It's a type of carbide.
Yes.
But then we got the silicon carbide ones, which are... So reliable now, you just rarely would use anything else.
No, friction resistance, you don't want any friction, is that what?
Well, you don't want friction. Different eyes got different heat retention, so you need that as low as possible, because obviously if your eye's getting hot under heavy usage, then that can affect the condition of the line.
Yeah.
You know, if you get it running too hot, or they can groove.
Yes, I remember those well. Early days, I've had groove ones.
And many fly rods still do.
Yes.
You know, still do. But
so your next phase is what? Glue that on there.
Well, I glue the tip eye on there. I use three different glues for rod building. See, different glues have a different shear strength. So I'd use the Flexcoat Rod Builder's glue, which is about a 20-minute set time on that. That I'd use for gluing Duplons, some and reel seats.
Yes.
Then I'll do a 5-minute one, which I'll use for the tip rings and so on. And then if I'm doing really heavy work, I'll use like an aerial diet.
Yes.
But essentially those glues, and then I'll use a high build resin for doing on the eyes.
I've got you.
Over the eyes and diamond wraps and all that sort of
yeah.
bits and pieces. But the resin is the finishing product.
Doesn't matter which order you put them down as?
No, no, as long as we get equal amounts of each, that'll be fine. And then there is a hot melt glue, which is readily available, but I'm not a great lover of that. I prefer to use the gloomy tips on. I have had them in the past where the hot melt, when they, especially on cardboards, when they sit in the sun for so long, they have actually moved.
Just in hot countries as well, I suppose you've got to be careful there.
Yeah, they sit out in France and whatever, they sit on the pods for days on end in the heat, and I've had customers phone up and say, these rods are moving, or why are these eyes moving?
Well, those hot melts, I always thought were for
very low
emergencies almost, really, like an emergency. You'd have a tube of or stick of that hot melt stuff just to get you out of trouble if you had a tip snap and had to buy another ring.
Yeah, if someone's walking up the stairs and comes in and says, can you do this for me?
Quick,
Then I would use that if they wanted it there and then. So once we've mixed that.
Now, another problem I've had as Monsieur Le Amateur is when you push it on with the glue, the glue pushes it back out again. I'm sure is that because I'm putting too much on, you think?
But then at least you know it's gone right through.
Yes.
And it's on. So it's not any harm. You just wipe that off.
So you're just rolling that tip in there.
Roll that round. And then also put a bit of glue in the end of the eye.
Yep.
Just so that does push up. And let's slide that on there. Give it a couple of turns. And then set that in line with where we want to.
I can see your black mark there,
Yep. And we'll set that in line with that. And then we'll stand that to dry against the wall.
And about 5 minutes does that?
Yeah, 5 or 10 minutes will do that.
Okay.
Yeah. And I don't worry about wiping the surplus off.
Yeah.
Because it's once that's dry, after about 20 minutes, it'll peel around nicely.
Oh, really?
It comes off nice and clean.
Oh, honestly.
Yeah, rather than trying to wipe it round, especially on a matte finished blank like this is, because obviously as you wipe it round, you can get like a little glossy bit showing.
Yes.
You know, so I just tend to let them dry. While that's drying, next stage will be to grind a set of eyes up, put a slope on so we get a nice even run up with the whipping.
That's on the, what do you call that, on the foot?
On the foot of the eye,
yeah,
either side. So we get a nice even run up.
Do you file those or what do you use to filing?
I used to want to file, but now I'll do them with the bench grinder.
Okay.
Right, what I'm going to do now, Graham, is grind these eyes. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to grind the foot of each side, each eye on both sides. But I don't want to take it down to a really sharp point. Just want it radiused, and take the edge down so that I get a nice run up with the whipping. A nice smooth finish.
That is a problem I found. Obviously a lot of amateur builders are going to stumble on that when they buy a new rod ring. They can't get the whipping to roll up the slope of the foot, or if you're going to go come down, it's you know what I'm going to say, it pops off and it's really annoying.
Yeah.
So you have to grade it, don't you?
Yeah, they need grading. Some have got slight tapers on, but that's not enough to do the job. If you try to go whip over that would just, it'd look a mess.
Yeah.
Because you'd get an overlap. So we'll take the edges off, nice sort of radius top.
Okay, and you use a grinder for that?
And I'll use a grinder for that. You can use a file. Keep the eye moving so you don't get no flat spots.
It's not a great deal you take off actually, is it?
No, very, very small amount. It's just enough to radius it. But you don't want it too sharp that it damages the thread when you whip it over. Next stage, I'll take a template, which is all laid out on all my rods I've used templates for, so all the markings are all laid out.
So that's for your ring spacings, yeah?
Yes, so I don't need to use a
tape measure all the time.
All the time. Each one's done because we do like standard ranges. Then I'll make a template for it. If it's a one-off rod or something, I won't worry. But on standard ranges, we use a template, and you can see everything's marked up.
And this particular blank, is this a carp rod or is this a pike rod?
This is a pike rod. This is a pike rod. It's a 12-foot pike rod. So what I'll do then, I'll lay that on the template, and then I'll mark each, well, the position of each eye. So I'll mark one for the back of the eye, and the two for the whipping, where I want the whipping to run to an end. And I'll go further down the blank.
How do you come up with those measurements then, Graham? You know, who decides that, the manufacturer or you, the blank manufacturer?
The company I'm working for, they'll give me a design that they want, but failing that, I'll do my own. If I'm asked to, I'll do my own.
You know where to put them, yeah.
And we'll work out where to put them.
Because for the beginners, you need enough rod rings on there so that when the rod's bent, the line doesn't either cross or touch the blank.
Yes.
That's the idea of the rod rings, to keep the line away from the blank, isn't it, really?
That's it, yeah, that's basically it. But you want it to pull a nice arc.
Nice even curve.
If you haven't got enough eyes or the wrongly spaced, you'll end up with straight runs, which will cause more friction and it won't use the blank. You want enough eyes on there to use the blank for its best performance. Okay, then what I'll do, once I've ground the feet at the foot of the eyes, I will just test that they're all lay flat on this stone surface, so that they're all flat. So once they're on the blank, I want them the whole foot laying against the blank. Otherwise, they can taper up. So you want them fitting flat. Those will look pretty good. Yep, that's all fine. Finding the little marks that we'd marked earlier, I'll take the eye on, obviously in line with the tip eye, and I'll just work my way down.
Just masking tape for that?
Yep, just masking tape for that.
I could only do one ring at a go, because as I'm spinning it up on my lap, I'd knock all the other rings out of alignment.
All
because
right.
You've got a proper bench here to support them all, so you're okay to put them all on in one go.
Oh yeah, we'll put all these on in one go, and then we'll move over to the bench and we'll whip them on. Okay, Graham, now once I've got the eyes set, I'll put a small mandrel in the end of the section, which is just literally a mandrel just to hold the section into the whipping machine, which is a centerless chuck. Tensioning plate, maybe I'll have a spool of thread on there. That will run down through an eye, through a tensioner.
I've got to ask, how much thread is on there, approximately?
On there, it's about 3 miles of thread.
3 miles on that one, yeah?
Yep.
So these other pulleys, these little wheels down here, they're for what?
They're for tensioning. This one carries two threads. Each one's for tension. So different threads come different sizes.
So you can adjust on the top there, that little nail nut?
Yeah, we'll just adjust that. But you get an A and a C and a D thread.
Yeah.
The sizes are generally used.
And that's movable, that other eyelet you've got in your hand there. It goes up
that
and down.
There, that's a feed. That will feed the thread onto the up the blank as I go. In a minute, and then we've got the two steadies up there at our end, so it doesn't. We don't want it bouncing, so we've got one steady there, and at the far end, we'll put steady just over the far end. Take that over just to stop the whole thing bouncing.
Gotcha.
Then we'll come back to this end and start it off. Right, here we go. So we'll come across there. We go over, under, put a thread over.
So you sort of overlap it to start it, yeah?
Yeah, just cross over the first thread, roll it round so you get it so it's straight. Once you've got that position, finger on.
Now this bit you're doing now is to increase the strength of the ferrule where it goes into the bottom of the blank, is it, this piece?
Just supports.
Supports it,
yeah. Supports that section, yeah. And also, cosmetically, it looks better as well. So we'll just tuck that under, half a dozen turns, and then it'll leave us a tail to cut off. In this case, we'll just use a Stanley knife, run it back, cut that off, and then we're ready to feed the thread up the blank. And that's done by use of a foot pedal.
So it's like an accelerator on a sewing machine?
That's right, yeah, works very similar. And then we'll feed that, we'll gradually feed that up the blank until we get to the far end. And then we'll need to tie that off again. Okay, so just before we get to the end, about six turns away from the end or where we want to finish, we'll put a loop in.
Put a loop in. Is there a name to that? That whipping loop? Or
I'll just call it a loop.
Yeah.
And we'll just tuck that underneath the thread, facing back in the opposite direction that we whipped it, and then do a further half a dozen turns.
Now, another mistake I've made
position we want to feel to
is putting too many whips up there, and then I can't put it through.
You
it's too tight.
You only want half a dozen.
A classic mistake, folks, not to make. Don't do too many. You're about six to finish off that whip.
Yep. Cut the thread. Then we want to pull that thread back. Place it through the loop. Pull it through. Then we pull that loop through the thread. Like that. Once we've got it to there, just give it a tug, run the nail round, just to tap all little flat, then pull it back, just opens the threads up, so we pull it back, pull it forward, slide the knife bow blade down the thread.
Carefully as well, I imagine.
Carefully till a stop, and that will cut that nice and clean and doesn't leave any tufts, then just push it back together. A lot of people make the mistake of trying to cut it off on top of the thread,
yep.
And that'll leave you fibres and little bits of flick sticking up.
Yes. Yeah. I'm saying yes, then, I've done it. I'm nodding vigorously.
Then you put the resin on, that'll all look horrible.
Yeah.
It'll just all stick through, little spikes. And that's that bit's done. Then if you want to, we can put a tipping on, which is a much smaller, known as tippings, and these can be any colour.
A bit of combination tinsel of or coloured, contrast colour, would that be right?
That's it, yeah, it just finishes it off. And there's so many colours around now that people can have pretty much what they like. Quite popular, as I'll whip a rod in a football team colours. Someone will phone and ask for a rod whipped in their football team colours. And again, so we do three turns. Cut off there.
So you do a lot of red then? Liverpool,
Yeah, with all those. Yeah, Birmingham we do, and Chelsea's a popular one.
Never thought of it. Yeah,
it's quite popular. So we'll tuck that under, put the loop in again, as you saw there, and then we'll just do three turns, and then finger on that just to keep the tension on there, through there, and then we'll just give that a pull that through. Run a finger around, just to tighten it all up. Tug it back.
Got to be very careful not to cut the thread underneath, haven't you?
Yep, very careful. There we go. And that's done. Right, we'll just, again, we'll put the thread over as we did before. Cross it over. Rotate the blank till we've got that straight. If we don't get it straight first time, we can move it slightly just by pulling to the right.
Again, another problem I've had is having that at a slight angle, and you're trying to play catch-up all the time, you know, and you have to keep adjusting it with your nail and everything. Get it level. You've got to get it level to start with.
Got to get that level, that level, otherwise it will just continue. Half a dozen turns. We'll cut that off. And there. And then we'll just continue up the blank. So, and then we'll run as it touches the foot, just as we touch the foot, we want to just make sure that
that's the tricky bit,
that
isn't it?
That's the tricky bit, we'll just get that up there, and then we'll just
ease it back with the nail and just to get it level
back. As it comes up, we just want to make sure we keep those tight.
And then once you've got that...
Once we've got that, then we'll just carry on up the rods. And we'll just pull all those tight. Keep it nicely tucked in. Thank you. Right, that's that one finished then, Graham. So I'll carry on and do the rest of the eyes, and then we'll move on. Okay.
Consider yourself a fisherman. Just how far do you want to take it?
Okay, Graham, we'll start on the butt section now. Right, we'll take the butt section, we'll measure up the cork. We're going to use a full-length parallel cork, which we'll mark up.
People still so traditional, they like corks, aren't they? They like freshwater,
traditional corks, yeah, which is a nice finish. A lot of people prefer the modern abbreviated cork, but it varies, but a lot of people are still keen on the cork. So we'll just overlap the end of the blank by about a millimetre, just on the end there. Then we'll mark where we want the cork will end up. Put that on there, mark that. Then we'll take a reamer.
Now what is that? What's a reamer?
This is a tapered reamer. It's for boring the corks.
Oh, I see, internal bore.
Internal bore, yeah, because obviously the inside is tapered, so we want that to taper to the same as the blank. And we do that, that's a gripped tape.
And this is all rough, so people know this is like a little file. Oh, it's quite coarse, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it's coarse. And and that will gradually bore the cork out to take to suit that blank.
Because this is tapered, isn't it? People have to remember this is...
Yes.
The blank is getting fatter at the bottom, so you've got to allow for the thickness here, the internal diameter, I guess.
That's it, yeah. Yeah, so we'll bore that down to where we need that to fit. So it should come on nicely.
Is it difficult to get the corks nowadays? Is it something that's dying out as much as the actual material?
It's a bit easier now. There was a time when the good quality cork was difficult to get, but now there seems to be a much better supply now. I mean, it's because of the champagne and bottling companies have gone on to this rubberized.
Oh, I see, for the bottles, yes.
For the bottles and stuff, so some of the better quality corks left. Right.
So we're going to slide that on from the small end first.
Yeah, we're going to slide that on from the front. Slide that down just to make sure that will come down to where our mark is. Yep, which is just there. So we know that's going to finish there. And there. So once we've got that and we've checked that, that'll be fine. Right, then we'll start that back up. And then we'll put
an expanding glue on that.
And we'll just rotate that round the blank.
What's the cure time on that? Is it like the modern expanders? Are you going to work quite quickly, or is it not too bad?
It will expand quite quickly, but I like to leave it overnight to dry.
You're spiralling that up there.
Yep, spiral that round the blank. Don't need masses of it, but evenly spiral it along the blank.
And the cure time on that, is it, you know, do they come in different speeds? Or
you wouldn't want to be handling it within a couple of hours, really. No, but it's much better left, sort of 5 or 6 hours. And then we come just up to the point of contact. There we go. Keep it rotating all the time.
Is that so it doesn't get droplets on it?
Yeah, otherwise it'll all sag down to one side. So we keep that rotating, slide the cork up, and stand it upright, and bring the cork to it. But keep it spiralling as we go.
You're sort of twisting so that it doesn't overflow, I guess?
That's it, yeah. Just keep it twisting all the way up. And that will. And any surplus then can slide off the end there. And then we just make sure we come to our mark, which is there. While that's going off, Graham, I'm going to mark up for the winch fitting. So we're going to use an 18mm Fuji DPS on this one. And we'll just mark where that is going to go. And then we'll take this up. Now that's something that might be strange, using a masking tape to actually pack the real seats out.
So it's just to give you a bit more space?
Yeah, it packs out to the real seat. But it's one of the best materials. Been using it for years. And it enables us to bring it parallel for the real seat and stuff and really get quite close. So we'll put that up and wrap that round. We'll slide the real seat up to there. And we'll
allow space for glue as well.
We'll just allow just a little bit of space for glue. But we'll put, you have gaps in between the tapes, as you'll see in a minute. Yep, that's that. Take that back there. So we'll put that on there like that. Wind that up, and that, so that section's fine on that. So we'll take that back. And we'll put the next section.
Oh, I see. So it's supported front and back.
Yeah, and in the middle. And we'll just have small gaps in between.
And that's where the
bulk of the glue will sit in those gaps. Well, once that is taped up, then we're going to move the reel into position. But I'll glue that up with a epoxy glue, which is a 20-minute rod builder's glue from Flexcoat.
What is that, a two-part?
That's a two-part glue, yeah. There, which I'll bring in for an old friend of mine, Mr. Tony Fordham.
I remember the name.
He used to build rods himself years ago.
Would that be from the Davenport and Fordham age?
Davenport Fordham.
I actually had...
Tony Fordham, I don't think he's building many rods these days, but...
I still have.
Still has the agency for the.
I think I had a couple of Davenport and Fordham Fast Strike rods. They were called.
Oh right.
I think they were honey coloured glass.
Oh really? Right.
Yeah, I remember those. Yeah.
Yeah, Tony used to produce a lot of rods, and most well known for the Sportex brand. And, right, so that I'll just glue that on that with there.
Sure. And you have a bit of a foregrip at the front there.
Yeah. We've got 2.5-inch cork foregrip with the collar inserted.
What's the collar for, just out of interest?
It's a stainless steel collar. It's just a nice finish.
It's a finish, yeah?
Yeah, it's just a nice finishing. Looks nice with the resin up against it.
It's like a plug that goes in there.
That's it. It's just bored to size. We'll put that in the front.
And then slide it down again.
Slide down over the butt section.
And again, expanding foam on that?
No, that'll be... Because it's not wide enough for expanding foam.
Oh,
so
I see.
I'll use a two-part epoxy on that bit.
Okay.
Because there's not enough room.
The same one, the flex coat there?
Yeah, it'll be the 20-minute one. Yeah, and then that'll just push down the size, glued in position, like so.
So the next phase will be what? They used to have a sort of... What do you call it up there? A butt section whipping or something? Or do they not all have that?
In front of that, I'll put an 11mm... piece of black whipping there, and then just this side of the name I'll put two small tippings in black. This is what this customer requires. And then I'll high build resin over the top.
Now, some have their names on them. Do you actually do sign writing with the name and that on them, or are they transfers now?
We do both.
Yeah.
Transfers and what have you, but then I'll have my ex-wife that comes in and she'll do the handwriting.
Oh, so it's handwritten name?
Yeah.
Or whatever they want on there.
If they want them personalised and that, they'll... she'll come in and write whatever they want written on them. It's like birthday messages, retirement messages, anything they want really, which she'll come and do.
So now with those, when that's glued up, let's assume that's going to glue, because we're letting the butt base go off at the moment at the bottom.
Yeah.
We could put it in the rack and we could show them how to put a butt ring on there?
We can do.
Yeah, that'd be good, okay.
Yeah. So you can see the glue is expanding there now, so that'll just come on, just rise to about 1/4 inch above the end of the cork there. And then I'll cut that off when that's dry. Okay, Graham, we're just going to whip this butt eye on here. This is a 40mm butt eye. Biggest we go to is 50mm. But different people expect different things from their rods. So some people will prefer a 40mm ringing, some prefer a 50. People have their own preference. With the wide spools these days, a lot of people like to start with a 50 and then code it down from there, going from a 50 to a 16.
So generally for long distance casting is a bigger butt ring, is it?
Generally speaking, yeah, generally speaking. But 40s and 50s are the most popular. Whereas a few years ago, we would have multi-range ringing, which was much smaller, and more guides. Would that be a seven? Most carp rods and pike rods now have sort of five or six guys on, where we used to use sevens and eights in the multi-range.
And why less rings, you know, like that? Why is that to do with the blanks, is it? Or reduction in friction? They just want to cast further?
Yeah, we want a lot of it's preference. Some people will say, oh, if you've got to have a 50mm, but you'll cast further. I personally don't agree with that. But a lot of people do. I think it's just on your style of casting, the way your reels and that are loaded, to what actually works best. But personally, on my own personal rods, I wouldn't have anything over 20mm as a bow eye. But that would be unusual, but it is my preference.
And they're up to 50s, you say, now?
But they go up to 50s. 40s and 50s are the most common, going down to either a 12 or a 16mm tip. I mean, these are Keegan guides, which are the Sydenham carbide guides, which is pretty much the standard now on carbon pike rods. Use Keegan's or S-Lights, depending on the brand, obviously. Or you can use a K-Series. Now, a K-Series eyes, which are the Fuji eyes, they all lean forward.
Oh, yes, I've seen them, yeah.
And that is to help with the anti-tangling, because if the rod's not set up right, you'll get a crack-off, which is where your line has run round the butt eye, and then obviously cracks off. But inevitably, if it cracks off, it can always cast that much further. Yeah. Some people will just endorse what they sell, which I think is wrong. The worst thing you can do is to actually trying to influence someone is to what you like personally.
Now
because that way you're not necessarily going to get them what they want.
Yeah.
Whereas if you listen to people, which I have done over the years, you know, you've got a pretty good idea of what they want to achieve.
Now the main thing here is, as well, obviously, you know, you build for Conoflex, you do commercial building, you've been doing it for years, you will build for private people. If somebody wants a bespoke fishing rod,
they
should get in touch with you to do your own. You know, you can refit an old one, as you were telling me.
I'll strip and rebuild, and bring it back to like new, all new fittings and whipping and that on. Yeah, that's a major part of what I do. You know.
Refurbs. I call it a refurb.
Yeah, refurbs, or strip and rebuild, whichever you prefer.
There we go. There's another customer wants a rebuild.
That's it.
Okay, now do you finish off? I have seen at the top end below, like where the ferrule goes, that they have a whipping in. Is that for strength as well, or is that just a decorative thing?
That would be just a decorative thing behind there.
Because the other side that goes over the top is the one you have the strength whipping round.
Yeah, this is already reinforced, but some companies do prefer a piece of whipping there.
Yeah.
But there's no real necessity for it.
We're not gonna varnish this one now, but you've got some here that are in, you know, getting towards the finish stage. Can we take a look at those?
We can, yeah. Right, this is a finish rod, which I've done for another customer. That's had the high build finish on the whippings, which have been done. And then this customer is, we went from the winch fit, and he didn't want a cork finish, he wanted a heat shrink finish. So that's a shrink tube, full length shrink tubing, stainless steel butt cap, just with a swaged end.
What do you shrink that with? Like a hairdryer or something, or a heat gun?
I'll heat that with a heat gun.
Yeah,
just feed it gradually down the blank, and it will gradually, but it comes in lots of different
sizes. It'll all tighten up, yeah.
It'll all tighten up, but you have to get the right sizes to fit to suit the blank. It comes in several different sizes.
And this one's got a jumbo button.
And this one's got a 50mm eye.
A 50, yeah.
You know, so say the mine are the most popular.
Most of the fish I catch would wind through that.
You're lucky you get out to catch some fish.
I know, the way the weather's been, yeah.
But yeah,
that's the build you get. Let's move that section out and just look at the butt there.
Yes, that's the finish. That's a finished build.
So a beautiful, almost glazed, sealed unit there.
Yeah.
But obviously we used to use varnishes. That doesn't look like a varnish. There's no brush marks.
No, that's a two-part epoxy finish. Because again, I prefer to use the flex coat finish, but there are.
So that's flex coat all the way up and down.
That's flex coat just
with,
just,
a, with
just,
like a fine brush
just
or something.
Over, just over the whippings, because a flex coat finish. The actual finish on the blank is a tint. It's a resin tint on the blank.
A two-part, or does it come straight
out?
Yeah,
it would be two-part, that tint, but that's put on at the factory where the blanks are manufactured.
Oh, I see, yes, yeah.
And the rest of it is a two-part resin.
So that's what you call a high build whipping, is it?
That's why this room needs to be so hot. That's why we're...
Yeah.
It's warm. It's warm. It has to be warm when I put it on.
And to seal all in here as well, because, I mean, that's almost like sealed in plastic.
Yeah, it all has to soak right through. The air has to come out, and... the warmer it is, the better that'll be.
And at the top end, you can see that little tag end above what the ferrule there, can't you?
Yeah, we can move that up to there to put the other end on there if you wanted to see that as I finished. All right, we put that together.
And this one's a carp one for long distance fishing, so?
Yep.
A 12.
Long distance carp fishing, 50 millimetre ringing pattern on there. Not on there.
Those are ginormous rings, no question of that.
Yeah.
I can see it there. And carbon all right through this one, yeah?
This one's carbon right through, yeah, full carbon.
What would this retail out, a rod like this? What are these normally coming?
These are, I think they're around the £300 mark.
Oh, man.
But of course, I'll build these for a customer, I don't retail these.
Myself. Yeah, yeah.
So, these are built for a company.
And what would a reef... Oopsie. What would a refurb cost on a general carp rod? Because, I mean, they're standard fittings for you. What would that cost?
That would vary very much depending on the eyes you want, style of the eye you want, size and whatever.
And if the customer wanted anything fancy, names written?
Yeah, it would all... you would have to sort of work that out individually to what the customer wanted.
Yeah,
Okay. Right, Graham. Don't just do black whipping. I can do any colour you want. We've got... blues, reds, greens. Now most of these are whipping these days are nylon.
Yes.
Which is a nylon thread, which again you can get two different colours from. By one you could preserve it.
And diameters are different?
For instance, this could be, as that is with a colour preserver, that would stay that colour, maintain that colour. Or to get a darker colour blue, leave the preserver off, let the resin soak in, and that will give you a different colour blue. Much darker. So you generally get two or three colours out of each stable colour.
I see.
Different shades.
Now, yeah, that will go darker with the preserver, would it?
Without the preserver.
Without the preserver.
Go darker, yeah. You generally get about three different finishes from one colour, depending on how you lay up your finishing. So a lot of those would be nylons these days.
And these are what, flat threads? There's more threads there than my grandmother had in her sewing box.
These are all metallic threads. Which do add a nice splash of colour. And
you'd use those for tippings, is it? Would you?
We can use them as base colour if we're doing under wraps.
Yes.
But then a lot of colour, we just add these to do tippings and whatever on each side of the eye. People can have two tippings, whatever they want. And then going back years back, we would use NCPs, which I still use a lot of.
That's these on the wooden bobbins?
These are flatter. Yeah, these are a flatter thread. Some of these go back quite a few years. The orange was something we've been using since the 60s, but still put them on the rods occasionally. Browns have never been that popular. People tend to stay clear of browns, but there's plenty of colours there. But again, nylon, NCPs. Again, all look nice if you just want a flatter looking finish, if you don't want it flashy. But these do give a nice tint, and then we've got back over here.
Is that just a standard white, that one? Is what
that's a white NCP. Yeah, use that on the tip of beach casters.
Yeah.
And whatever. People don't want necessarily a fluorescent tip, but they want to see it. Or on the tips of an uptide. We use it on quite a few uptides these days.
Okay.
And we normally just do the top two, between the top two, maybe the top three eyes. It's just really for visual, a bit better indication. Then of course we've got the bulk spools, which I'm using when I'm doing long runs of rods.
Okay, it's brilliant. Thank you very much for all your help here, Graham. I mean, it's quite an insight into rod building, and I can see the vast number of mistakes I've been making all over these years. But nice to see something done perfectly, something done by a professional. And I can see you've got the reel there.
There we go, Graham. That's it, reel one, fit and ready. We're ready to go fishing now.
All you need is a bit of water.
A bit of fish.
And we're off. Brilliant.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that totally awesome episode of How to Build a Fishing Rod by a true professional rod builder who's been around a very long time, been doing thousands and thousands of fishing rods. So, even if you don't fancy building your own fishing rod, why not get in touch with Graham Dadswell, see if he can give yours a complete overhaul if you've got an old fishing rod, new whippings, new rings, new corks, maybe a new winch fitting. You can go fishing with it and enjoy it then, because let's face it, fishing rods almost become personal friends. We'll see you next time.